in Easter literally refers to the time of year in the spring when the days become longer than the nights. But for the person who knows Jesus Christ, Easter means a lot more than that. It means that even though Jesus died, salvation didn't. Even though Jesus was buried, hope wasn't. Because Jesus is alive. Easter means there is forgiveness for my failures, grace for my guilt, and mercy for my misery. Easter means that the pain and the silence of living in a Saturday world isn't purposeless and it isn't permanent. Easter means that I can't out-sin the grace of God and I can't outrun the reach of God. It means that Jesus is King, light overcomes darkness, justice will win, and brokenness will be broken. Easter means that the scars on the hands of Jesus are telling a story of victory, not defeat. And the same is true for me. It means that I am not alone, not ashamed, not forgotten, and not forsaken. It means that the rain and the storms and the wind and the waves of this world will not have the last word, because my future is a resurrected body with the resurrected Jesus on a resurrected earth. Easter means that I can join with a choir of saints and angels singing, "Oh death, where is your victory? Oh grave, where is your sting? Oh hell, where is your song?" Easter means that as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed my transgressions from me. And as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for me. Easter means that even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, because you are with me.
Well, welcome, everyone. We gather today to celebrate the greatest event of the church year. And we are here to celebrate an amazing thing. I mean, we celebrate every week, but this week is just a little bit special. It is the greatest event. It's something that changed the whole world. It's not a virus. It's not a note from the president's desk. It's not even a miracle cure for every world sickness. This event is so wonderful. It changed all of our calendars that we order our lives by. It changed our world. It changed our laws and government. Today, are you ready? Today, we gather because Jesus is alive. Are you ready with this? He has risen. He has risen indeed. He has risen. He has risen indeed. Join me in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, today we celebrate. Today we worship our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ. Through his death, his burial, and his resurrection, he has conquered sin. He has conquered death. Sin no longer needs to reign in our lives, and death has been swallowed up in victory. Today, Jesus, we worship you. Every day is your day, but this day is just a little bit more special. Help us to remove our focus from all the things going on in our lives and to worship you. For you are worthy of our praise and worship. Amen. Join us today as we worship Jesus, our Lord and Savior.
Thank you. And what a great time of worship. I'm so appreciative of our worship team and those in the sound booth that are making all this possible. What a great time of worship. May we continue to worship him in prayer. Paul tells us about our Savior, and we begin to glean into how special this day is. As Paul writes in Philippians chapter 2, starting in verse 5, he says, "Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who being the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name. And at the name of Jesus Christ, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And every tongue confessed that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father." And so Paul tells us what our attitude should be, what our mind should be. And it should be just like that of Christ Jesus. So as we begin to pray, we pray, Father, give us the attitude of Christ. Although he was the creator of everything, he took on the role of a servant, of a slave, and humbled himself even to the place of death, death on a cross. Holy Spirit, teach us. Teach us humility. In our day, we need humility. We need the humility of Christ to pick up the towel, to wash feet, to become the servant of all. Our Father, give us humility as we seek you, as we celebrate and desire to be like Christ himself. And Father, the way to be exalted is to be humbled. Thank you for Paul's words here, for helping us understand that as Christ humbled himself, he went lower than anyone else to wash feet, to die upon a cross for those like me who were so undeserving. But as Christ humbled himself, you exalted him above all. You say above all of which every tongue will confess, above the earth, on the earth, below the earth, that Jesus Christ is Lord. One day everyone will, whether they'll be made to or whether they will just see him high and lifted up, and they will, just because it is a truth. But Father, today we're not made to. Today we gladly confess that Jesus Christ is our Savior and Lord. And so as we come to you in prayer, Father, may we have the mind of Christ. May we glorify him today and every day. May we exalt him. May we lift his name on high in the way that we speak, in the way that we live, in the way that we work, in the way that we humble ourselves and pick up the towel and we wash feet. May we become the servant of all. May Christ truly be our example. But Father, we know that that is not our nature. That is not what we desire in and of ourselves. But as your Spirit is planted firmly and deeply within us, we know that that is our life, because that is what we were created to do. And forever, forever, for eternity, we will praise you. We will lift you high and exalt and worship you. And our lot is to praise Jesus Christ. And so may we do that. And so today, as we celebrate the resurrection, may our lives, the way that we do everything, the way that we associate with one another today, the way that we eat our Thanksgiving, our Easter meal, the way that we do all things, Father, may they exalt you. Our very souls, our lives, our spirit, we love you, Father. We worship you today. Because you live. Because you live. We pray this name and exalted Jesus Christ. Amen. And amen. amen. Wow, what a time of worship. So good to join you today. And I wish that you were here as we were having it here at the church, but it's great to join you where you're at today. And before we open up God's Word, and we're going to be in Luke 24, Easter is one of those days where we just love to give. And it's one of our greatest offerings of the year, because as God has given us so much in Christ Jesus, and Jesus gave his life for us, we desire to give back to him. And desire to give back to him in proportion to what he has done for us. And he has given us his all, and may we give him our all. God said that he has given us his all, and he asked that we give back a portion of that, first fruits, the first 10%. And so may we do that, and knowing that we are blessed, we give God so much. He allows us to keep the other 90%, and may we bless him in what we do with that. May we pray. Our Father, we thank you for all that you do for us again. And our offering today, our Easter offering, may it truly be a blessing to you. You have so blessed us, and we desire to do something for you, Father, but not just give you something, but give you our very best, our first, knowing that the rest will meet our needs as you fill in, Father. And so we bring our needs to you and ask that you meet those, that you define those, but take our first fruits, bless them. And may they go and meet your needs here in our community, but also around the world today, everywhere where you're working, Father. We pray this with a very thankful heart. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, a very familiar Easter text that we're looking at. We're going to be in Luke 24 today, and we'll be looking at the first part of it in verses 1 through 12. Join me. Luke writes, "But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking the spices they had prepared. And they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, 'Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but he has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified on the third day and rise.' And they remembered his words. And returning from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the rest. Now it was Mary Magdalene and Joanna, the mother of Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. But Peter rose, and he ran to the tomb. Stooping and looking in, he saw the linen cloths by themselves, and he went home marveling at what had happened." Our Father, we thank you for this text today. Thank you for the word by Luke today. And just as it was true that day, it is true today. Aspire it to our hearts, Father. As we open it up, may your Spirit teach us, we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Some of you have probably seen the movie entitled The Help. It came out in 2011, and it was up for an Academy Award. The backdrop for the movie, it was set in 1960 in Jackson, Mississippi. And it was during a time of segregation. And so across the track were was the African-American population, and then the Caucasian and the rest on the other side of the tracks. And the white households would invite the African-Americans to come over and do household chores 5, 6, even sometimes 7 days a week. So they would come over and they'd hire them, and they would cook, they would clean, they would do nannying and take care of children. The main character in the film is Abilene. And Abilene comes over and works for a family, and she takes care of a little girl by the name of Mae Mobley. And Mae Mobley, as they introduce her, she's a quite chunky little baby, little girl at the time. And they said that she would probably be chunky, she wouldn't be a beauty queen. And so that kind of sets the stage of what Abilene would speak into her life and over her life. She would tell her, usually during times of crisis when things weren't right, but she would tell her, "Mae Mobley, you are smart, You is kind. You is important. And she would just proclaim that over her life. And what a great part of the movie, that phrase. And it resonates with us for a few reasons. First of all, it resonates to us because it's true. It's true that you are smart, you are kind, and you are very important. And so it's a truth today that can be proclaimed, and that is very true. Even when our world speaks to us and tells us anything but, you're not very important, you're not very smart, you're not very kind. We know these things to be true no matter what the world might tell us. And so those phrases resonate with us. But the other interesting part of it is that Abilene proclaims this over this little girl's life in a day in the 1960s where children were usually supposed to be seen but not heard. And here is this little girl, her parents caring very little for her. We find out a little later in the film that Abilene figures out that when she changes the little girl's diaper at the end of the day, she's still in the same diaper in the morning because her parents are so busy. Their social life is the main thing in their life, and it's not their little girl. And so they really didn't care for her, but Abilene proclaims over her life a proclamation that she is smart, that she is kind, that she is important. And so those things really resonate with us, that those are true, and how she speaks these over her life, that as she grows up, that she will know how important she is. No matter what the world tells her, she's going to know that she is kind, that she is smart, that she is important. Well, it's fascinating that it is the women that are the first to the tomb. And I love the question as they look and they peer in the tomb, and all they see is the linen cloth. And they are perplexed, it says. But then the angels, the heavenly beings, ask them, why do you look for the living among the dead? What a great question. I spent 23 years trying to find living things among dead things. I tried to find living things in sports. I tried to find living things in relationships. I tried to find living things in jobs. I tried to find life and joy in all the things that this life offers. But none of it was lasting. There is some happiness there, but nothing that would really bring life. But there is one thing that will bring life, Jesus Christ. And he is not in a grave. The grave is empty. And so what a great question for us to consider this morning. If you're looking for life among dead things, we find out from the angels that we're not going to find them there. And so the angels then invite them to remember. To remember. That of what Jesus had said, even when he was with you in Galilee, they said, that Jesus said what would happen, that he would die, but that he would be raised again. And so as they remembered their time with Jesus, their frown was turned upside down, and they remembered that those were the things he said, and that is what must have happened. And so they run away, they're excited, and they go and proclaim over lives what Christ has done, that he has been resurrected. And so they go and they preach it. They go and proclaim it. And so they didn't proclaim that you is good, you is smart, you is important. What they went off and proclaimed were three other things I'd like to look at today. When we proclaim that Christ is resurrected, that he is risen, the first thing we proclaim is that you are loved. You are loved. God created all things, and this very creation turned against him. But we are not sinners in the hands of an angry God. We are sinners that are running from a broken-hearted God. And God who refuses to give up on us. God is the one, and we see the picture in the prodigal son, that God has done all that he can. And he's waiting for us to return, to receive the grace, the mercy, and love that he freely gives. We must receive it. On the cross, Jesus said, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And we learn what love is, in that God is willing to go for us to the God-forsaken places. So there are no more God-forsaken places because God has already been there because he loves us. So no matter how neglected or overlooked you might feel this morning, I want you to know that you are loved. The message of Jesus' resurrection is a proclamation over your life that you are loved by your Creator. You are loved. And it's not because of your abilities. It's not because of your talents. It's not because of anything that you have done. You are loved because you were made in the image of the Almighty God. His imprint is upon you. You belong to Him. And that is where your value comes from. And He says, I love you. I love you enough to die for you. You are loved. But also when we proclaim the gospel message, we learn that we're loved, but we also learn that you are forgiven. You're forgiven. The cross was a cruel instrument of death. The Romans were very good at death. They found ways to torment, to make people suffer and die in such abhorrent ways that people would not cross the Roman government, that you would not rebel. And suffering upon a cross was the worst, most humiliating, most painful way to die. When you died on a cross, you had nails put through your wrists and through your feet, and you hung there working, straining to get every breath. And so you had to lift your weight up off those nails and off that cross to take a breath and relax. And so eventually, some people hung there for days, for a couple days, and finally they would be so emptied of strength they couldn't lift themselves up to take their next breath, and they would asphyxiate. But then the Romans would leave them hang there, and they would let people walk by and see them to know that if you cross us, if you cross the Roman government, if you rebel, this is your lot. That is how Jesus chose to suffer and die, because He loves us. The old theologian said that Christ could have called upon 10,000 angels. But the old preacher said, we love Him, and we know how much He loves us. Not because He could have come down, but because He stayed up for us. He stayed on the cross. Jesus remained on the cross for our sins, to pay the price that He didn't owe, so that we could live the life that we were created to live. My friends, you are loved, and you are forgiven because of Jesus Christ. But in the resurrection, we also find out that we are new creation. For anything who is in Christ Jesus is a new creation. Now, we're not just loved and forgiven and just have to stay in our mess and endure this until Christ returns again, but we are a new creation in Christ Jesus our Lord. We don't need to live in our messes we've made of our lives. We don't need to live in our brokenness. We don't need to live in our emptiness. But the good news is that we are a new creation in Christ Jesus our Lord. We don't need to remain broken. And the baptism of a Christian gives us that exact picture, especially that of immersion, where we are buried with Christ. We die, but we are raised up a new creation in Christ Jesus, to glorify Him, to serve Him, to love Him, to know that we are loved, that we are forgiven, that we are a new creation, and Christ's Spirit reigns within us to do that which we could not do for ourselves. And if you're trying to live the Christian life in and of your strength, if you're trying to do the things that we read in here that we know that we should be doing, we're not going to do it. We're going to fail. We need the power of God within us, the power of the resurrection itself, to do, to be, to become. And that is the power of new creation. We have that in Christ's resurrection. And so the women received the message at the empty tomb, and they remember the story of Jesus and how He was telling them the whole time that we are loved, that we are forgiven, and that we are new creation. The old has gone, the new has come, and now they are being asked to go and to proclaim it. Just like the women did from the tomb, now we are being asked to go and proclaim it, to speak that reality over the world so that they will know that they are loved, that they are forgiven, and that they are new creation. And so let me tell you what we do here every single week. If you are joining us today and you're wondering what we do every week outside of Easter, outside of Christmas, let me tell you what we do. Spoiler alert here. We're going to take this book, all 66 books in here, and we're going to tell a story from here every week. We're going to look at something. You know what it's going to tell you? Every week, we're going to remind each other that we are loved, that we are forgiven, and that we are new creation. We're going to remind each other of that. We're going to convince each other of that because that is truth. But then we're going to do the one more thing. We're going to leave here, and we are going to go proclaim it. Proclaim it because there's a lot of hurting people out there that this world has told that they're no good. That they don't matter. Their lives don't add up. But that's not true, is it? We are all made in the image of God. Jesus Christ himself is our creator. And so he reminds us that we are loved, that we are forgiven, that we are new creation. And then he tells us to go and proclaim it to others so that they would know also that they are loved, that they are forgiven, and that they are new creation. So every Sunday morning, we're going to remind each other of that. And then we're going to go proclaim it to the world until they know it also. But then we're also going to proclaim it to the ends of the earth, around the world, everywhere where God's at work. We want people to know that they are loved, that they are forgiven, and that they are new creation. And by the way, that's not a lie. If it was a lie, the story that we would have read would have ended on a cross. It would have ended in a tomb that was not empty. It would have ended there. It would have ended with brokenhearted people that just went back to fishing, just went back to lives that they lived in. It would have ended. But it didn't, did it? The tomb was empty. You know, something amazing that of all scientists that look at the empty tomb and study the resurrection, even those who are not Christian, from all different religions, all different walks of life, 96% of scientists who study the resurrection account, they believe that Jesus rose from the dead. They believe it. It is true. And it's also true that you're loved. It's also true that you're forgiven. It's also true that in Christ you are a new creation. So my favorite scene in the movie The Help is when the book is discovered. So the black help began, they were encouraged to begin to tell their stories. And it was put in book form, and this local Caucasian girl put all their stories in a book. She wanted to write a book. She wanted to be a journalist. And she knew that it wasn't right. She knew that they were being mistreated and taken advantage of. And so she told them to tell their stories. And she wrote them down. And the book was published. And I don't know, like 24 different people told the stories and put it in the book. And so the book was published and it became a hit. People across the nation were reading the book called The Help. And then they figured out because of the uniqueness of some of the stories, some very funny, some very sad, and some good. But there was one very funny story in particular. You have to watch the movie. I won't tell you what it is. But they knew that the setting was Jackson, Mississippi. And it would come out that it had to be Abilene who was the inspiration for this. And so Abilene, as she went back to the house of which she was working, she was asked not to come back. And so the scene where everyone begins to cry, Abilene goes to little Mae Mobley, and she tells her, "Remember what I have taught you." And little Mae Mobley, she looks up at her, and just as Abilene always said in the same southern drawl, she says, "I is smart. I is kind. I is important." From a little child that was about 3 years old, she learned. No matter what she did or didn't get from her parents, no matter what she did or didn't get from her world, when things were at their worst, she was going to know she is good, she is kind, she is important. And no matter what this world tries to tell you today or through the year ahead, may I proclaim over your life today that you are loved, that you are forgiven, you are a new creation in Christ Jesus. Thanks be to God. Would you pray with me? God, we gather today to remember. And now that we remember, We proclaim to each other and to those we meet who need to hear this good news. We proclaim that God, in and through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, that we are loved, that we are forgiven, that we are important. And Father, help us to remember that. Help us to help others remember that. Because this world and the tempter that's in the world doesn't speak those things. But they speak just the opposite. And Father, send us into this world, a world that needs to know these truths. And may we proclaim it louder. And may we proclaim it better than our culture, who tells us that we are unloving and broken and unworthy. God, we praise you. We praise you for being a God of love, a God of mercy, and a God of new life. So if there is anyone among us this morning who has been lied to, may the Holy Spirit and God's people proclaim to them the good news of resurrection. The good news that you are loved, that you are forgiven, that you are new creation. Let me say one more thing. He is risen. He is risen. Father, thank you for the resurrection. Thank you for Christ humbling himself, taking on death, and you saying the great amen, so that we could gather today and say and proclaim that he is risen. Our Father, we pray this in the wonderful name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. And all God's people said, amen. God bless you. Happy Easter. Thank you for joining us today. May God bless you. And may you know that you know that you know that he loves you. And the power of the resurrection proves that you are forgiven, that you are a new creation. Know it and proclaim it. God bless you. Thank you for joining us.